My name is Agnes. I'm from Deaf Women Included. So with AmplifyChange, with the grant, we are focusing on sexual and reproductive health and rights for deaf people in Zimbabwe. So we are still trying to have the peer education, the peer educators who live in the communities. So if we can't go to the communities, it means that we delegate some of the roles to the community peer educators, because they have like full information, and also we're trying to build a relationship with the health workers so they know how to do it. So before we went to Mashingo and we had health workers, and who, these health workers, they made a promise that they want to continue learning sign language. So the peer educators, actually, they agreed to be there and support the health workers in that bit. And also they accepted that they would teach the nurses sign language, and then they would continue with the program. It means that they will be visible within the program and also within their communities. And we know that if we have the peer educators, they would continue with our program, because with the COVID, it's difficult for us to be traveling. And also sometimes we have to also cut the budget and also see how we can solve some of the challenges. Because now, for example, we are working from home. It means that we need to pay out of pocket and also buy data. And then it has also increased some of the expenses for us. So it's now difficult for us to follow the budget that we had initially, because there are other things that we now have to pay. And also maybe if we want to meet another person, and other people, they don't have their cars, but because there is the lockdowns, then they have to look for taxis and other alternative methods, because the public transport is not so safe, because it's like they're overloading, and then sometimes some of the people don't have masks. So there are a lot of challenges, especially with the budget, but we are trying to also look for the other ways of how to work, like alternative ways. If we can't visit, then we try to also find alternatives, and also how to also protect the people and also make sure that we are safe in the office and also in the community. I think sexual and reproductive health, it must be prioritized, because for now we have a lot of women and girls who are not going to school, with schools closed. Some of them, they're experiencing abuse in their home areas, and maybe they fall pregnant at a very young age, maybe 15 years or maybe younger. So this one is a child, but also now they'll be having another child. So life is difficult for them. And then for some of them, if they go to the hospitals, they don't even have like the necessary preparations for giving birth. But also sometimes even for some of the young girls, they don't have like sanitary pads. But so we can't just focus on the COVID-19 pandemic and forgetting sexual and reproductive health. We should prioritize it, just like other non-communicable diseases like cancer, etc. Because for some people, for example, let's say who are poor, in poor communities, some of the children, they are forced to get married at a younger age, maybe to old people. And also the rate of HIV, maybe it increases. So I think that it's important that we advocate for the elimination of child marriages, and also we also advocate for women and girls with disabilities. Because for some women and girls with disabilities, they are suffering a lot within their communities. After COVID, we just have to also focus on sexual and reproductive health, and also children who are out of school, and also poor people. Because a lot of people have lost their jobs and lost their livelihoods. And we know that sexual and reproductive health is not a luxury, it's a necessity. So we need to have a budget for sexual and reproductive health and rights. And I think that it's important that funders be able to communicate with their grantees, because there is the COVID virus, and sometimes it's difficult if we have like a rigid budget and also a rigid grant. And also it's important that people have self-care within their budgets, because for now a lot of people are going under mental stress. And so if you don't take care of yourself, sometimes maybe you fall sick, or maybe they're also mentally unwell, which can affect their also their well-being, but also their ability to work within their communities. So I think that it's important that we take care of our community, but also we prioritize self-care within our budgets, because it's difficult if you don't have a budget for that.